Hi, everybody. I'm Brad Swanson. I'm the director of commercial sales for Unilock Midwest. I want to introduce the speakers today. Mark Schmieding is a licensed architect, AIA fellow, and digital practice consultant based in Chicago. He was presenter of BIM Beyond Buildings class at the last ASLA conference. And Nehama Schechter Baraban is COO at Arc Intelligent and a landscape architect. So they'll be our presenters today. Thank you.
Thanks, Brad. So hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. It's really a pleasure presenting for the Illinois chapter, and I hope you will find what you see today insightful and helpful. I'm a landscape architect by trade, and I'm the COO at Arc Intelligence. We have started in a landscape architecture studio as part of our demand to start delivering landscape projects in Revit. And my boss, Ilya Volokhin, was a landscape architect back then. So when he started to create one or two features, and soon enough, he saw how much demand it had. And today, we're one of the leading tools in the industry to allow landscape architects to implement BIM. We're very proud to deliver a very wide set of tools, more than 60 tools, to help you design topographies, retaining walls, geolocate files, even tools for interoperability. And we will try to demonstrate them more and more. So the story was that we met Mark Schmieding, and he's been in charge for more than a few digital transformations in architectural companies. And throughout his experience, he found very little landscape architects that could collaborate with their architecture firm in BIM platforms, specifically in Revit. So then our relationship began, and he started to focus his career on helping landscape architects transition to Revit, just like he did with architects before. So with no further ado, Mark Schmieding, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Nehama. That was a very great introduction. You said a lot of the things that that I talk about that got me into this. You know, a big part of my career was transforming architects into BIM, in Revit, cloud, et cetera. And it is absolutely true. I put together teams, I'm out there working, and so many architects want the landscape architects on board with them. And I saw these advancements with the environment for Revit, also with 2024, which I'm going to talk about, because actually it's the two of those things plus the cloud that make me believe now is the time for landscape architects, and what got me so enthusiastic about pursuing this and kind of jumping into this part of the AEC market. What I'm going to do is I'm going to share my screen. Okay, so what I'm going to do is try to go through a bunch of things very quickly. If you have questions, you can type them in the chat. So if you can see my screen, I'm going to do a very simple example. I have a site. I'm going to do a park, right? I'm going to put a pickleball court or playground and kind of sculpt it and give you an idea how that process might go. Okay. One thing I'm going to show you before I get going is, because this will come into play later, is with the new topo solid, and also with particularly with tools and environment for Revit gives you, I'm going to show you this 3D view. So you can see, I actually put in a topo solid. I just did it very plain to cover this area. Revit doesn't just have, 2D, 3D. It also has 4D, like phases. So you can see, if I just show you this site, I say it's existing and it's going to be demolished. Now with that done, we're not going to look at this again, but I wanted to show you underlying when I get to the cut fill parts that you can benefit from. This is how you do it. You have an existing topo, and then you go and manipulate the topo that you have to, get that information. So here you can see I've started sort of sketching some lines. A lot of landscape architects work with contours. To tell you how Revit and topo solids work is they actually don't work with lines, they work with points. And they give you some tools to add a point or two, I'm going to show you. But the way we're used to working in landscapes is kind of defining a contour and getting them to make. These are nice elements, but it's actually these environment for Revit tools that kind of give them the functionality that you really need to manipulate stuff. You can see the different ways you can sketch in Revit, draft, as you might say. And I'm going to use a spline and kind of do another one here. I'm just going to sketch that. Now, instead of clicking each one individually, I can actually just do a crossing here. And you'll see it'll not only notate all of them, but you're going to see in the 3D view, it's actually allowed me to take the contours that I just sketched, but now give them the 3D element that I can use, to create my topo solid landscape. Okay.
So the thing is that as landscape architects, we're always used to work with these contour lines, but when we're transitioning into the 3D BIM environment, we're working with a surface, and surfaces are never defined by contour lines. So these contour lines are just the abstract way for landscape architects to understand, the three-dimensional shape. But 3D surfaces work with points. So the entire idea of what we try to do with Environment for Revit is to allow you to work with these points, which are great because the more points you have, the more accurate and flexible your surface can be. But we're used to working with contour lines. So what we're trying to do is to kind of streamline your work with points. And that's what you're just going to show them right now, the topography tools. It's going to allow you to combine, you know, this feature of working with a three-dimensional surface that is defined by points, but actually work in a convenient language and landscape architectural language.
So like I said, and thank you, Nehama, that's exactly it. Like the element they've given us is topo solid, great element, but they have not given us the manipulation tools. And so most of the stuff you're going to see me do has to do with that. Now, I'm going to show you this. There's many tools. There's add line. You can go from edges. You can pick faces. I'm not going to go into all these tools, but right now I'm going to do the add line tool. Okay. So I go add line, and now kind of starting down here, I'm just going to pick all those contour lines that I did. So you can see here, it's now added these points along the contour lines, and I can go ahead and say add line, right? And then finish. And now you're going to see, instead of a difficult way, I've actually started to get, and I'm going to modify this as we start to develop the site, but I'm able to push and pull the points more in the way that I'm used to, rather than trying to analyze points, et cetera. So now one thing I'm going to do is I did some sketching. Now you can bring in an image, you can bring in a sketch, and I have just the detail line of the outline of a pickleball, a couple pickleball courts, okay? So now you can see this is a detail element, which is like drafting. So I can go into any view and draw with my drafting tools in Revit. I already had this done, so I'm just going to use this as information. And what I really want is the size of the platform, the surface that I want. Now, one thing I can do is I can actually go, okay, let's see what it looks like at 8 feet. You know, when I move this around, right, I'm moving that surface, I'm kind of using this as a design tool by playing with elevation, is I want it to be at a point where the cut and fill might be more reasonable. So this is the difference, like you're sketching in 2D, but you'll see one of the advantages, especially working with, you know, outdoor surfaces, topographies, landscapes, is the elevation and where things are. It's very easy to use the tool to get what, you know, to get what you need in that way. So now I'm going to come in and pick this one, and you'll see I have this built up, but now what I'm going to do is I think, you know, instead of sloping this down, which would go onto the court, I'm going to put retaining walls here. Okay. And if I come in here, right, I'm going to go ahead and, you know, click wall, do that, make sure that I have the location line that I want. And you'll see, I'm actually going to start it from where, you know, it's kind of, this one's going to go all the way, right? So I have my two walls.
It's great to see it in 3D view and in 2D view as well, because, you know, a lot of us are really used to like design and sketch in 2D view. But the nice thing in transitioning to Revit is that whatever you do in this 2D view also reflects in the 3D. So ease into the 3D world.
That's a good point, because some people think of it as a documentation, Revit as a documentation tool. And I'm so used to using it, and you can see with these tools. So Nehama, for example, I know in plan, I put the walls here, but now looking in 3D, I can see, well, I certainly don't, you know, that's either not attractive or excessive. And I can come in and just use the Revit tool of, you know, kind of coming down with the wall.
Yeah, so I really think that, you know, some of us are used to work in 2D, and that's a great way to start with Revit, but slowly but surely you're getting addicted to the 3D view, because there are a lot of things that you can understand better when you're at 3D, I mean, design-wise. So it's nice to see both on the screen right now.
And a point on, in terms of when you sketch and the things you get, I just want to kind of highlight some of these. If I go into annotate, instantly with the spot slope, you know, I can tell what kind of slopes I'm having. You know, this is zero, but like I said, I can make that one, or this is a big slope. So as you're doing your contours, you actually get this feedback. You can figure this out immediately. Actually, let's just show you one of the nice view features. I'm gonna do a section, right, through the site this way. Okay. And you can see, I can get the topography. You know, this right now is going back further. But I just wanna show you, here's that wall that I did. And I can actually, you know, this is where you get the benefit of working this way, because I can go spot elevation, right? And then, like, actually, everything is sort of related. So even if I modified this wall, the elevation would change, et cetera, right? So, you know, those are some of the nice things. So I just did this wall, but I still have this land, this soil going over my court. So this is, again, one of the nice things in about the new topo solid is that, one, you have the profile on the outside, but you can actually, if I edit the sketch, I can come in. This was just, you know, that surface. And I'm going to go ahead. And also, if you have an internal profile, it cuts it out of the, you know, so you can do the edge, the corner shape or the edge shape, but you can also pull things out of the topo solid. So, and now you can see here, I have my topo surface, my retaining wall, my grading going up here. And so you can see I'm starting to get a cut and fill balance of my site. So that's one of the things that while I'm working, I can see, like, I'm making design decisions, and then they can be based on information like that. Like, I don't want to have it too imbalanced of, you know, the cut or the fill. Okay.
And I have to say that this blew my mind when I started to work in Revit. And that's plain Revit. Just, you know, you can get a schedule from anything you have in your model. And I remember one of the first projects I made, and they're like, okay, but can you give me an estimation of the earthwork? And I'm like, yeah, just wait 5 minutes and I'm going to get it. So it was life-changing. I think these one in the sections were really life-changing for me.
I've done, you know, some very sloped surfaces and different pieces. And it's just really nice because it just allows you to really break things down in a granular level and see what each of your elements is doing in terms of that, in terms of affecting the topography and cut fill. So I'm going to go into some of the planting features. I'm actually going to drag out a group that has the plants that I want in it. So now I have, these are some of the
elements. You prepared the planting palette that you want to use.
Exactly. And this is very typical for firms, right? Is you're going to have either mixes or elements or things that you're used to using, you know, it's like a visual palette for me to do. I even architecturally, sometimes just having a palette to the side is kind of a nice feature. But I want to show you also how elements, like if I took this, right? And then as I move it, if you notice, look, it knows in Revit, you see how it goes up or down, like it knows that that's the host. So I'll just put one right there. So when the topography changes, the elements on it will go up and down, not just for looks, but for plans and for sections. It's just great. So I'll go over here. There's area scatter. I'll show you that in just a second, but I'm going to do line scatter. So the first thing it wants me to do is draw a path. You know, I can select some information, but just to show everybody, I want to do just something like this. Right? So there's my path. Once I do that, it lets me, I can pick it on screen, or you can see I already had it selected. So I've got the element I want to do along there. And I don't want it to be irregular. I want it, let's say 5 feet between them. So I'm gonna go ahead and try that and just say apply. And so you can see that it has done that surface and it has gone, you know, again, modifies it according to the topo solid. And I'm gonna finish that scatter. Okay, the next one I'm gonna show you is an area-based one. And it's gonna, and I want this area that you see up in this corner is where I want to randomly put some trees. I'm gonna pick area scatter, select that area, you see. And I can say apply that selection. Pick on screen, I'm gonna pick this guy, right? So I have that tree. I want it to be a regular method. I want it to be 2 feet off in boundary. Let's say 34 of them, right? And find my host and create assembly. So I'm gonna click apply. Using Revit, a lot of times you have to randomize stuff. This is planting.
Yeah, and there's different levels of smoothness that you can apply to it. So it's really, you know, graphically, a lot of times people watching what I do and they're like, yeah, but can it look different? So the answer is yes. I mean, Revit is very flexible, both in the amount of smoothness that you get, both in the graphical standards. It's all about, you know, the way you implement the software and how you adapt it to your office standards. I just want to finish up, you know, with allowing you people to imagine what would your project look like, because the workflows that Mark just demonstrated, they can apply to any scale projects and you will never have to wait for the architecture background. It's just there. It's a 3D model. But from this 3D model, you can actually extract and create any deliverable. So, you know, I urge you to just start imagine what you would do with such a tool, or how would your workflow improve utilizing BIM and starting to work, you know, with data-driven design. I think that would be my last take for today.
So can you go back to the one you showed with all the different architectural and, okay. And I just want to say, you were saying, and which is true from the landscape architect's point of view, you're like, we'll always have the backgrounds, we'll always have the buildings, whatever. And this is my point from the architect's point of view. We want you in the cloud. We want you with us because your design should be influencing the buildings and it should happen more quickly. Like it should be part of the process. And that's what's happening now in the cloud, is all this information is being gathered and stored, and you want to have your stuff there while you do it, suggesting changes, being part of that, you know, influencing the design. Yeah, we get all the landscape, you know, when we need it. So it's a really good process.
All right, to cut it, to finish off, Mark is in your hood. He is in Illinois, in Chicago, and he is available for free consultation for anyone who wants to understand how to start learning Revit. So his website is now in the chat. And anything else? And
if I can mention on that, let me know, you know, if you're interested in talking or you'd just like me to give that to your office for people to get credits. But yeah, I'm around. I'm in Chicago.